Good afternoon, everybody. I know you're all hungry, so hopefully I'll have something that'll make you get even more hungry. Acknowledge my partners in crime, Fred Gemitter, and Emeritus Professor Bill Castle, part of the team working on variety improvement at CREC. Okay, I guess I didn't listen. There we go. So first I want to show a few slides on our scion breeding efforts in the greening world and what's happening there, what promise do we have. There we go. The first slide here I have is a hybrid orange-like fruit that's actually 8% trifoliate orange, if you can imagine that. We were always taught that you can't easily breed sweet oranges, and you all know that trifoliate orange tastes terrible, but this particular hybrid makes a juice that taste panels have not been able to tell it has any trifoliate orange. In fact, taste profile is right in line with Hamlin's and Valencia's. It's very juicy, and so far, greening hasn't touched the plant, so we're doing further evaluation on that. It has been approved for release. It does have another issue in that this past year, after a 6-inch rain, a lot of the fruit on the tree split. It does have a relatively thin rind, so we're hoping to be able to figure out how to deal with that by horticultural manipulation. And we're also trying to determine if we can grow this particular hybrid orange without psyllid control. So I have an experiment to see whether that's possible. So anyway, now we know how to make hybrids that are bringing in genes from trifoliate orange that could make them more tolerant or more resistant to Huang Long Bing. And so we're making more of these sorts of hybrids. This one is a triploid, so it's also seedless. I want to show you here an interesting tree that's right on the center in one of the blocks when you drive up the road past the greenhouses. In 2011, this tree had severe blotchy mottle from Huang Long Bing as PCR positive. And of all things, it's on Swingle citrimolo, the rootstock that you've heard about root collapse when trees get infected with greening. So we've been monitoring this tree. It's a sweet orange pumelo hybrid. Both of its parents are susceptible to greening, but this particular hybrid is showing very good tolerance. The tree health has improved each year. We've now been making crosses on it for scion breeding and for rootstock breeding. We're testing it as a potential interstock, and we're also testing some tetraploid seedlings that we got as potential for inarching. Grafting notes to some young infected trees in the field. Very interesting. The fruit's kind of in between an orange and a grapefruit, so it has some commercial breeding potential. But this is an example of how our collections of breeding material, both at UF and the USDA, are undergoing a natural screen. So everything's being exposed to canker in Huang Long Bing, and we are seeing lots of different reactions. Some things die right off as soon as they get it. And there are many things that are looking very interesting, particularly some pumelos and pumelo hybrids and some mandarins. This is a population of hybrids that I got by crossing Page with the previous hybrid in an effort to produce hybrids that make an orange-like fruit. And with this, we got a strange result. We got diploids, triploids, and tetraploid progeny. Of course, the triploids was the goal. To get seedless fruits that are like an orange. So we're growing all these out, and they'll all be evaluated for fruit quality and also their tolerance to Huang Long Bing. So this is the type of crosses that we're making with material that we're finding in our collection that shows promise. This is an example of a mandarin in Dr. Gemitter's program. You can see it's right next to a whole row of trees that are being impacted by Huang Long Bing, and it's just still looking outstanding. So there are a few of these showing up, and of course this is being utilized in hybridizations both by conventional breeding and by cell fusion in the laboratory. We've got quite a few pumelos that look very interesting. We've been screening pumelos for a long time for tristeza, soil adaptation, and so forth, because rootstock breeding efforts to try to resynthesize something like sour orange. Sour orange is half pumelo and half mandarin. We have some that have turned out to be quite good to eat. This is one that we've recently released And it's showing very good tolerance to Huang Longbing so far. In fact, the tree's not impacted at all. And there are a couple of other ones that are quite delicious that are also showing very good resistance to both Huang Longbing and to canker. And so, of course, we're using these as breeding parents in efforts to breed grapefruit-like fruit and orange-like fruit that will have problems with neither of the diseases. Here's the kind of cross that we do for canker resistance. We're trying to make triploids, so we have tetraploids from cell fusion that we're crossing back with the selected red pomelos, both that are showing canker tolerance in the field. And in this case, both of these trees are showing some fairly good tolerance of Huang Longbing. So you got a red pomelo on your left there, showing very good canker tolerance. And then you see the tetraploid parent on the right. That's a fusion of Murcott with the red Chandler pomelo seedling number 80. And you can see the tree right next to the parent is just full of canker, and yet there's no canker at all on the breeding parent. So this is a very promising way to get grapefruit-like fruits that'll have delicious flavor, good red color, and possibly tolerant of both Huang Longbing and canker. Lots of these babies from these types of crosses are going into the ground this spring. Now we're also finding out something that I find really interesting, in that not all the sweet orange clones are reacting the same to greening. We are starting to see some that look a little bit tougher against greening than others. So we're really trying to zero in on this because it's very useful information when you're choosing a sign for replanting. This is a topwork tree out at Ori Lee's Alligator Grove east of St. Cloud, and we've got a collection of Soma clones of a set of oranges I call the OLL series, which stands for Ori Lee Late. We are seeing that the majority of these clones are holding up better against Huang Longbing than regular Valencia, although they do get greening. There is one clone so far that still doesn't have it. But anyway, we topworked some very highly symptomatic trees of Valencia on Swingle that were scheduled to be removed because of their poor productivity. So here we've topworked OLL number 7. Onto an infected Swingle root system with an infected Valencia interstock scaffold wood. And this tree has since, this picture has flushed out again. It's got quite a few flower blooms, so it's going to be setting a crop, and it's still PCR negative. We don't understand this at all. We would fully expect that the bacteria would move right up from the infected root system and scaffold into the sign, but so far it has not done this. There are three trees like this where the same result has happened. And so we're following this up. CRDF has funded a major top working experiment. We just finished having 320 trees top worked with some promising sweet orange type selections that we hope to be able to pinpoint which one is actually the toughest against Huang Longbing. So far, OLL number 4 actually looks the best. And it's in the parent tree program being cleaned up by DPI, and the first two trees just reached Chiefland. So we're going to be scaling up the budwood of this particular clone and getting it released to the industry for large-scale use. It's a wonderful orange, just a fantastic orange. High color, high solids, high juice content, and high yield. So everything about it is good. Now I want to show some slides on our rootstock breeding efforts, and this is also an exciting area. Dealing with the problem. I know we can't do things fast enough, but we're trying our best. There we go. First thing I want to talk about is sour. Everybody seems to want a replacement for sour orange that doesn't get tristeza. Again, as I mentioned, sour is a hybrid of mandarin and pomelo. Half the genes in it come from the pomelo, which was the female parent, and half come from the mandarin. Sweet orange is also half mandarin and half pomelo. Many people are finding that there's a double whammy when you have a lot of blight. So we're looking for rootstocks that can handle blight to help with Huang Longbing. Sour orange types are very good in that regard. You can see up here that our more vigorous rootstocks, lemon, bulk, rough lemon, Palestine, sweet lime, and rancor all have citron as their source of vigor, and they all are highly susceptible to blight. So maybe going to the pomelo mandarin combination is the way to go to get things that are widely adapted, especially to the calcareous soils and that can also handle blight. So we've been making a lot of hybrids at the tetraploid level and the diploid level, trying to combine selected mandarins and selected pumelos to maximize the chance of having good babies. There's a couple ways you can use sour orange. You can actually use sour orange as a parent in the cross, and Kim Bowman at the USDA has quite a few hybrids with sour orange as a parent. Some of them look very interesting. Or you can also try to resynthesize sour orange-like hybrids by screening pumelos for the traits that you want, screening mandarins for the traits that you want, and then hybridizing those together. We spent a lot of time on this, on the latter approach here. Up here on the A slide, I know it's hard for you to see some of these in the back. These letters are small on these small screens, but we've made quite a few hybrids of Harado Buntan Pumelo with three different mandarins, Shikwasha, Amblycarpa, and Cleo. Many of them look very, very promising, although the trees are still fairly young in the trials. We have released two. One is a hybrid UFR-15. It's a hybrid of Harado Buntan and Cleo. And the second one is number 16 is Harado Buntan Pumelo with Shikwasha Mandarin. The Shikwasha Pumelo hybrids are very precocious, so it's easier to make progress more quickly in the breeding effort. But it looks like a lot of the Cleo hybrids are starting to rise to the top and look very, very interesting. One of the problems when you're making Mandarin Pumelo hybrids is the majority of them don't produce the right kind of seeds for nursery propagation. You need new cellar seeds where the embryo inside the seed is identical to the mother. But instead, in many of these hybrids, we get typical zygotic seeds that are a random half of mom and a random half of dad, which means that each seedling is different and they're not uniform in the nursery. So less than 10% of the hybrids that you get here make the right kind of seed for nursery propagation. So if you find a really good rootstock that doesn't make the right kind of seed, then you have to consider cuttings or tissue culture propagation if you're going to utilize that selection as a rootstock. And so we're, of course, researching that component of it as well. This is a picture of Valencia grafted to one of the Pumelo Cleo hybrids, number 48. These are three-year-old resets out at Ori Lee's in a very high-pressure greening area where the trees at this age produce so much fruit the branches were cracking off. So we're very excited about this. We've got more than 10 trees of this combination in the trial, and they all look really good. Unfortunately, this one does not make the right kind of seed, so it's being propagated now for putting into tissue culture and again to make rooted cuttings. We get to figure out how to make this thing work. Here we go. Yeah. Okay. This is another grapefruit hybrid planted over in Vero Beach with Tom Hammond. And Tom Hammond has really challenging soil. He has diaprepes, and in times of the year when it's dry, he has trouble with his water. Very high pressure greening area. Many of his commercial resets are never going to make him any money. A lot of them already have crashed. We've got a series of these Cleo Pumelo hybrids over there that went through a salinity screen before we planted them. We propagated them by cuttings and put grapefruit on them. In this case, a ruby red over there. There are four resets that are 3 years old on this particular one, and all four of the trees look like this. And trees right next to them are collapsing, so this is a very promising candidate. Again, this one does not make the right kind of seed for nursery propagation, so again, we're utilizing alternative means of propagation to get the numbers that we need for large-scale trials. We do have a couple of these Cleo Pumelo hybrids that are making the right kind of seed for the nursery, and so we're getting large-scale trials set up with those. Here we go. To continue along the line of breeding, what can we do to get the right kind of seed? Well, if you get your polyembryoni from trifoliate orange, then you're up in the chance of getting it in the babies by about 50-50 instead of less than 10%. And so we're now trying to dilute the trifoliate contribution into the Mandarin and Pumelo hybrid by crossing with some other things that have some trifoliate in them that have done well, like US812, X639, for example. And this is working. We've already found one Mandarin Pumelo hybrid crossed with US812 that the two-year-old tree in the field is already flowering and producing the right kind of seeds. Also, I mentioned that we're doing this work at the tetraploid level. We've done a lot of work with cell fusion where we can hybridize complementary rootstocks together and get all of mom and all of dad together instead of a random half by doing cell fusion in the laboratory. We've tested many of these hybrids in the field, and some of them look quite good. So now we're crossing the best of those, and again, focusing with a large dosage of man and a large dosage of pumelo in the babies that we're making. Many of you have been to our field days at the St. Helena Project east of Dundee, where we've tried to do what you've heard a lot about today, which is minimizing the stress on the trees by using a slow-release fertilizer and also daily irrigation in short durations. We've got more than 75 rootstocks under evaluation in this trial. Trees are now 6 years old. We have 3 years of data. And there's a lot of difference in the performance of the rootstocks, and it's really hard to sort it all out at this point because the trees are only 6 years old, but there are some significant differences that are worth noting. Here's a picture of the trial from 2 summers ago. Many of the trees are still holding up, even though we have a 75% infection at the moment. This is what we were after when we started the trial. We were after rootstocks that would be really good for the new production systems for high-density plantings that bring trees into production very quickly, producing a lot of fruit on relatively small trees. This is a picture of Valquarius on orange 15, which is a tetraploid, I call it tetrazyg, which is a hybrid of two of the test tube baby hybrids that we made in the laboratory that was produced by conventional breeding. So this is the kind of rootstock that we were originally trying to find. This one's very interesting because it has one of the lowest frequencies of HLB infection in the entire trial. I have some data here. These are the HLB infection frequencies of the diploid rootstocks. And I know it's hard to see the numbers in the back, but the bottom line is that the commercial rootstocks have the highest infection frequencies of any of the rootstocks in the trial. Most are 80-90 over percent, with Cleo being the lowest of the commercial rootstocks. Yet some of the diploids have much lower infection frequencies, particularly some of these ones up in the upper left-hand corner, which are hybrids of Papita and trifoliate orange that we've obtained from one of our colleagues in Italy, Giuseppe Reforgiato. This is tetraploid data. And the tetraploids in general have a lower infection frequency than the diploids, and so that means that the infection will spread more slowly in the tetraploid rootstocks than it will in the diploid rootstocks. It was about half of what the level in the diploids in general. But again, we are focusing on ones that have the lower infection frequencies, and then hopefully we'll combine that with reduced symptoms once the trees do become infected, to have a double positive effect from the rootstock. Here's an example of a couple of infected trees on rootstocks that are showing reduced symptoms, Vernion Orange 4 and Vernion Orange 19. These trees have been infected for going on 2 years, and the symptoms are very slow to develop under these low stress conditions. So here I have some pictures that just show some of the diploids compared to the higher performing tetraploids in the trial. Up on the upper left, you see Kuharski that at this point in time was 86% infected already. And you have the orange 15 that I just mentioned that was only at 14%. Now that's gone up, the Kuharski's up to about 99 and the orange 15's up to about 50% now after 6 years. Swingle at this point in time was at 70, it's up close to 95 now. And orange 19 was just 23, and it's still hanging around 50% at 6 years of age. So you have to think about how fast would it spread if you had a solid block of trees on the rootstock as opposed to a mixed block with a high inoculum load from the more susceptible rootstocks. Again, I know it's since these screens are so small, you probably can't read all these numbers, but we have been taking juice quality and yield data for the past 3 years. This year we intend to measure the tree sizes on all the different rootstocks and measure the canopy efficiency. And of course, this year the yield from last year in the entire trial was down 18% as the trees went from 5 to 6 years old. So we have all of the data now. What we're going to be looking at is which rootstocks were able to maintain their yield or increase the yield when we know many of the rootstocks, you know, had a reduction in yield. So we'll try and be pinpointing in on the ones that are actually able to continue increasing yield in this heavy disease environment. I put a picture of sugar bell here because I'm going to show you some data of a rootstock trial, but sugar bell is a very delicious mandarin hybrid that was released a few years ago, and it gets greening really fast, but under really good horticultural care, it seems to be able to grow through the greening, and if you manage the trees properly, you can still do very, very well with this particular selection. It seems to really respond to good nutritional programs, and infected trees can maintain productivity of very high quality fruit. Mickey Page has kind of figured out how to manage these trees with a hedging and nutrition program out at Conserve too, and he did quite well this year with fruit from the sugar bell trees. And we had a young trial that with Emery McTeer that we're going to be losing because of a real estate deal, but we had 15 different rootstocks, and the second year we had a problem with the fertigation system broke down, and Emery accidentally missed a psyllid spray, and so almost the whole trial got infected with Huang Long Bing at age two, and the trees looked really bad in the fall. We went in January and treated them with biochar, and we put supplemental slow-release fertilizer down on the ground, and the trees came back really, really well. The problem was the first year after this treatment, the majority of the fruit was symptomatic, but the trees continued to do well. And this past year, a higher percentage of the fruit was normal. It was still a lot of symptomatic fruit, but some of the trees that had produced mostly symptomatic fruit the year before, some of them produced mostly normal fruit the second year after the infection. So there was a rootstock effect going on. We tried to get as much data as we could. We scored every tree visually, and we also have data on how many trees needed to be replaced percentage-wise for each rootstock, and you can see that there was a big difference with some of the experimental rootstocks scoring on average of almost 4 out of 5, 5 being a perfectly healthy tree, 0 being a dead tree. You also notice there on swingle, we left a couple of plots of swingle with no biochar, and they scored much lower than the trees that received biochar, which I think is also interesting. This is the entryway into a grapefruit rootstock trial over off of 60 in Vero Beach with Premier. And when you drive in, it looks pretty depressing. Most of the trees in the first few plots here are just totally failing. But when you get back into the trial, you'll find that there are some that look quite good. The whole plots of different rootstocks doing much better than others. And this trial contains a lot of citrate ranges that Bill Castle and Fred Gemitter made years ago. And there are quite a few of them looking very good, and they still look good today. These pictures are about 2 years old, but they look pretty much the same this year. Here's another shot showing a bad one going into some good ones. And here's some severity and yield data taken by Paul Ling, our field manager. And we've identified the trees that have the lowest amount of disease severity also happen to have the highest yield, a good correlation as you would expect. So we've picked out these sit ranges for subsequent release. Unfortunately, the seed trees were destroyed by the state's canker eradication program. So we're regrowing seed trees, and these, of course, are being entered in the tissue culture program so that we can propagate them and get larger numbers of liners to put in large-scale trials. But again, they're all these selections are sit ranges. Here's another tetraploid rootstock that has sour orange in it as one of the parents. It also has Carrizo, Nova, and Pomelo. On the left, you see some three-year-old OLL number eights as resets in a high-pressure area out at Ori Lee's, and on the right, some four-year-old resets at St. Helena. This one looks pretty good, and we've entered this into our release matrix. It'll be known as UFR-17. Greenhouse testing has shown us a lot. we do very robust greenhouse testing. We take bud sticks of Valencia from infected trees in the field. They're about this long. And we graft those into test rootstocks, the whole stick. So you're pretty sure you got a good slug of inoculum rather than just taking a bud where you might not have enough inoculum to cause a disease. And we try to make the top grow out from this infected bud stick. So one of our first experiments, you can see here on the left, we find one rootstock where the sticks grew out horribly, next to another one where the same bud sticks grew out, you know, relatively nice, although you could see some minor symptoms in the tree. So this showed us that, indeed, the rootstock can send something up into the scion to impact the disease. So this was a very exciting result for us and has encouraged a lot of the work since then. Here's that same rootstock out in the field in a tree that's been infected for 3 years. And we've noticed that although this rootstock is far from perfect, it's not the answer. It seems to have part of the genetics for what we need because it has very low level of fruit drop and a very low percentage of symptomatic fruit, even though the tree's been infected for a long time. So we know this rootstock has part of the genetics that we're after, but not the whole package. Again, it could be a good parent. This is a real interesting one, too. This is a picture of a tree of a Valencia soma clone on Orange 19, which is being released as UFR number 4. That's one of the ones showing the better performance at St. Helena. Now, what we did here is we had 9 clones of Rhodey Red down at Martin County in a trial, and they seem to be doing better than other oranges down there. So we got a permit to be able to work with field material. We brought it back to the greenhouse, grafted it to Orange 19, just because we had a lot of Orange 19 that was available. No particular reason at that time to pick that. We grafted all the plants, and Cecile Robertson, that works for Bill Dawson, inoculated them all in their greenhouse with greening. And then she came to me and said, "Judah, only a couple of your plants are showing any symptoms. You want me to re-inoculate them?" I said, "Please go re-inoculate them." So she inoculated them a second time, and still only a couple more showed some symptoms. So we got the permit from DPI to put them back in the field. So we put them over at Pico's Farm, and they've been there about 2.5 years now, and a number of them still look quite good. But it turns out that this clone, BHG-268, was a soma clone that when I went down to Martin County to cut the Rhodey Red budwood clones, I saw a couple trees on this that looked really good, so I decided to add it. It's not a Rhodey Red clone. It's just a standard soma clone of Valencia. So anyway, this one now looks the best out of all the clones in there, and there's a significant difference in how it looks to the other ones. And there's 3 or 4 trees that look just like this that have been over at Pico's, again, inoculated twice, and at Pico's Farm, which is a real challenging location. So it looks like there's a synergism here between the BHG-268 clone of Valencia and the Orange 19. So I'll be paying attention to this now, and here's another example of a rootstock scion synergy. This is N73 Valencia. It's known as Valenfresh. It's been released. It's available. It's a seedless Valencia, very late, holds quality into June. And I have 3 trees in a block where all the other oranges have been hammered by greening, and all 3 of the trees in this block look like this. And it happens to be on a rootstock, white grapefruit plus 50-7 trifoliate, that's in the middle of the pack at St. Helena. So again, it looks like there's a synergy here between this particular Valencia clone and this particular rootstock that looks quite interesting. And of course, we're going to be exploring this possibility. So thinking about the rootstock, I think there's tremendous potential for breeding. There's precedent. There's a paper on apple that shows that with fire blight, that the rootstock can stop the progress of a gram-negative bacterium, which is the same class of bacteria that causes both greening and canker. This got me really excited when I found this paper, because if it can happen in apple, it can happen in citrus. And think about it. How has nature dealt with major diseases throughout history of Earth? Well, you have genetic diversity that exists out in the wild. This new threat comes along, and even no matter how severe it is, there's always some genotypes in the population that can handle it. They survive, they continue to reproduce together, and the species survives and moves on. Well, we've kind of eliminated that in the real world in citrus because we've destroyed so much of the natural wild citrus. But the breeding programs have recreated a lot of genetic diversity, both the USDA's program and the University of Florida program, and that's why we're seeing some of these different genotypes out in the field that are responding the way they are, and we need to target in on them and take advantage of them as best we can. So I've set up a new rootstock screening gauntlet. Many of you are familiar with it because I've talked about it quite a few times. We make crosses at the diploid and the tetraploid level. The seeds are planted in calcareous soil that's been inoculated with both species of Phytophthora, Nicotiana, and Palmivora. And so only the robust seedlings are selected. They're moved up to 4x4s. We take the tops of those plants and we make cuttings from them to produce seed trees and extras that can be tested as grafted trees. And then the original liner goes into our Huang Long Bing house where it's grafted with a hot bud stick of Valencia. We flush that out. We usually get what you see on the left, which is highly symptomatic trees. Some of them even die right away. But we find a low percentage, 5 to 10%, give us what we see on the right, which is fairly good, healthy-looking flush that comes out from the infected bud sticks, and these are the ones that we get excited about. And so just to be sure that they are inoculated, they get passed through a hot psyllid house. So they stay in the hot psyllid house for a couple of months until we see psyllid damage on the leaves. And then if they still look good after that, then they go to Pico's farm under a permit from DPI. So here's an example of what we're after. You see one on the right there that's a dud. And then you see the other one. Again, this tree was grown from infected budwood. So it's a Valencia, grown from infected budwood. It's been in the hot psyllid house for a couple of months. And now it's growing off over in very challenging soil, looking like this. This particular one, the rootstock has Amblycarpa, it has Vulcomer lemon, it has Nova, it has Pumelo, Cleo, and Trifoliate orange. So the rootstock is a very complex set of genetics that, of course, the greening bacterium has never encountered before. And so we've got quite a few trees that this is one of the better ones, but there's quite a few that look promising so far that have been out in the field for over a year now. So, of course, we don't have fruiting seed trees of any of these, so any of the ones that look the most promising are, again, going to be propagated by cuttings and possibly tissue culture. So for rootstocks, I think there's going to be two waves. The first wave are these things that we're making very snap decisions on, trying to release something just to give you something that is going to work better than Swingle and Kuharsky. USDA is doing the same. And so these things that we're releasing now, they're not silver bullets, and they require very good nutritional programs and good psyllid control, but they have a chance to work, probably better than Swingle and Kuharsky. But the second stage, I think, is going to come from this more robust field screening and from the gauntlet material that we're generating now. And subsequently, I'm really hopeful that before I retire, I can deliver you a rootstock that will not even require psyllid control, because I know that probably cannot be sustained in the long run. I want to propose a concept here called integrated tree management. You've heard a lot about stress today, and I think that's really an important factor. So think about it. The greening bacterium does this. So in the wintertime, the populations are going up. In the summertime, you get thermotherapy, and they go down. And you've got a line across there where the population can cause a disease. So I think with a good nutritional program, you can move that line up. I think with the genetics of the rootstock, you can move it up further. And with the genetics of the scion now, maybe even further. And if you combine all three of those movements, maybe you can move that line to where there's actually no disease that you have to deal with. So in my integrated tree management suggestion here for a new acronym, ITM, you want to pick the best scion genetics. We're generating information on which oranges, which grapefruit clones might be the best. Best rootstock genetics you can get your hands on that matches your particular set of circumstances. And then the best production system. People that are working with soil amendments are getting very good results. I've been doing a lot of work with biochar because I'm trying to keep all my new little babies alive, and I've had trouble when I haven't done anything. So the use of biochar has been very helpful for me there, and I think it'll work for you too. People using sludge and compost are having good results. I think you need optimum psyllid control and foliar nutrition. And the first 2 to 3 years, what I'm having good results with is the use of controlled release fertilizer, and now I'm mixing it with Tiger Sol products. And Arnold Schumann has a blend, a Tiger Sol product that has iron, zinc, and manganese in it, three of the nutrients that you need extra for to battle greening. And what I think is happening is that the Tiger Sol, when water hits it, it's a slow release, chemically formulated, so you get a zone of acidification wherever the Tiger Sol is. And if you got controlled release fertilizer mixed in there, anything being released by that on a very constant level, it has a better chance of being taken up by the roots because of the acidification from the sulfur in the Tiger Sol product. So I think it's a really good combination, and we're seeing good results with it in the field. So again, anything that gives you constant nutrition and efficient nutrient uptake is going to be helpful. Then when the trees get 3 or 4 years old, it's too expensive to use controlled release fertilizer alone. Or if you're using fertigation, you could have a problem during the rainy season. When the rainy season floods your groves, you shut off your fertigation. Trees aren't getting any nutrients. They get nutrient poor and they're vulnerable to greening. So you can supplement your your fertigation with a controlled product, possibly a blend of with the Tiger Sol, and that will compensate for a lack of nutrition during this time when you got to shut your fertigation system down due to too much water. Okay, so when you move into 3 to 4 years, there's people out in the industry experimenting with this and having very good results, and you guys can talk to each other to find out who they are, but there's combinations of traditional dry with controlled release fertilizer with Tiger Sol. The amount of Tiger Sol, of course, is proportional to the pH of the soil. The higher the pH, the more you're going to need of that. And they've cut it down to 3 applications. So like in January, you can put out a blend that might have only 20% controlled release. And then you come back with your second application in April, and you're going to up the controlled release to 40 or 50% because that's got to get you through the rainy period. And then your third one is in the fall, and if you got controlled release in the fall application, then you got a little bit of nutrition being supplied all winter. I think it's very dangerous for our trees to be nutrient starved during the winter, which is something we've done for a long time, because the greening bacterium really likes a low nutrient environment, and I think you get a lot higher levels of replication if the trees are nutrient starved. So these are things that people are experimenting with and having very good results, and I hope to see a lot more of it. But I think when you combine these sort of programs with the best scion and rootstock genetics, you've really got a good chance of making things work.
Thank you very much.
All right, the next